Hey guys, in this video I'd like to talk about adrenomimetics. So what are these adrenomimetics? Adrenomimetics are nothing but group of drugs which stimulate adrenoreceptors. So which are these adrenoreceptors? Adrenoreceptors include alpha and beta. We already know it. Okay. So alpha is divided into alpha 1 and alpha 2. Beta is divided into beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. Okay, now adrenomimetics is nothing but what? They're mimicking the activity of adrenaline. So when they're mimicking the activity of adrenaline, they can stimulate alpha or beta receptor. When alpha receptor is stimulated, what will happen? When beta receptor is stimulated, what will happen? We will study both along with the drugs. So for that, we need to understand what happens when I stimulate beta 1, beta 2, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay. So let's talk about beta 1. Beta 1, already we know that location is in the heart and kidney. Okay, so what happens? Heart stimulated, increase the heart rate. Okay, what happens to the force of contraction? It increases force of contraction and it increases the conduction as well. Okay, when I'm talking about kidney, it will stimulate juxtaglomerular apparatus and increases the blood pressure. So let's talk about beta 2. Beta 2 is located, so I made it simple, it located in the smooth muscles. So smooth muscles of which organs? Smooth muscles of bronchus. Okay, now let's see what is happening when our sympathetic nervous system is active. We need more air to breathe in because our metabolic demand for the oxygen is increased. Now, what should happen to bronchus? Bronchus should dilate and sympathetic receptor is beta 2. So now bronchus will dilate. So when I stimulate beta 2, bronchus is dilating. If bronchus is dilating, what is happening? It is relaxing the smooth muscle. So it causes bronchodilation. Okay. Now, it is also located in the blood vessel. So it cannot constrict in blood vessel and dilate in bronchus. So blood vessel also dilates. We call it as vasodilation. It is also located in the uterus. Beta 2 is also located in the uterus. So in uterus it causes relaxation. So these are the important things we need to know about beta 1 and beta 2 receptors. So what happens when I stimulate beta 1? Heart rate increase, force of contraction increase, conduction will also increase. So based on this, we need to understand something. Whenever I stimulate beta 1 receptor, my heart rate is increasing, cardiac output is increasing and my blood pressure also increases. And meanwhile, kidney beta 1 receptor stimulation will also lead to elevated blood pressure because of activation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Now, when I am talking about beta 2 receptor, so stimulation of beta 2 receptor will cause bronchodilation, vasodilation and uterus relaxation. Now, let's talk about alpha 1 receptor. Alpha 1 is located again in the blood vessel. Okay. In blood vessel, it causes vasoconstriction. Also located in the smooth muscles of the urinary bladder, especially in the sphincter. We need to be specific about this. And when I'm talking about alpha 2 is located postsynaptically. Alpha 2 is located where? Postsynaptic. So I will explain what does it mean postsynaptic in a minute. Postsynaptic. Now I explained you what are the types of adrenoreceptors and what happens when we stimulate the adrenoreceptor. Now, let's see how adrenaline itself is produced, noradrenaline itself is produced in a neuron. Okay. Now, let's take a neuron. So, here we have our... So this part we call it as synapse. Okay. This part we call it as presynaptic membrane. it is called as presynaptic membrane. We call this one as postsynaptic membrane. We call this one as postsynaptic membrane. Now, let's see how adrenaline and noradrenaline are produced. So, we have tyrosine, amino acid. Okay. This tyrosine is transported into the neuron along with sodium ion. Along with sodium ion. Now, where is our tyrosine? Our tyrosine is in the neuron. So, this tyrosine, whatever is inside the neuron, will undergo formation into dopamine. This dopamine will further get converted into adrenaline and noradrenaline. So what happens is, we have something called vesicles. Okay. So this dopamine, whatever is produced, it will enter into the vesicle. In vesicle, our adrenaline and noradrenaline are formed. So now dopamine is transported into the vesicle, then our adrenaline and noradrenaline are formed. Okay. What happens every time we receive a signal, every time we receive a impulse conducting through the neuron, what will happen? Our voltage-gated calcium channels in the presynaptic membrane open. So calcium will enter inside. Okay. Now entered calcium will bombard with the vesicle. Now what will happen? This vesicle will fuse with the membrane. And neurotransmitter will be released into the synapse. So now we have adrenaline and noradrenaline in the synapse. Okay. Remember the place where I was talking about alpha 2 receptor? I was naming it as presynaptic receptor. Okay. Now, whatever adrenaline, noradrenaline is produced, it will stimulate the receptors on the postsynaptic membrane, and also it will stimulate the receptors on the presynaptic membrane. So these presynaptic stimulation will give a inhibition of neurotransmitter release. So we'll tell that stop releasing adrenaline and noradrenaline. So this is a role of our alpha 2 stimulation. Now, with the help of alpha 2, if I want to treat a patient who is having hypertension, so what I can do is stimulate the alpha 2 receptor so that it will tell not to release adrenaline nor adrenaline. So decrease neurotransmission will decrease the blood pressure. So this is one of the way to treat the hypertension. Now let's see about adrenomimetics, right? So when we are talking about adrenomimetics, first we need to learn about the substances, that is catecholamines, that is adrenaline and noradrenaline. So let's talk about adrenaline and noradrenaline first. Okay, now we have catecholamines. Okay, so catecholamine like substances, catecholamines, that is adrenaline and noradrenaline. Okay, we have adrenaline, noradrenaline. How the work of adrenaline and noradrenaline determines, let's see. So adrenaline will majorly stimulate alpha 1 receptor, alpha 2 receptor, beta 1 receptor, and also beta 2 receptor. When we are talking about noradrenaline, it will stimulate alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, but there is no action on beta 2 receptor. So noradrenaline, no action on beta 2. Noradrenaline has no action on beta 2. Adrenaline has action on beta 2. Okay. Now, if I want to classify adrenomimetics, I can classify the drugs into which are acting directly on the receptor, they are called as direct acting drugs. When we are talking about indirect acting drugs, they are like some or the other way, they are having a effect of stimulation of adrenoreceptors, right? So catecholamines comes under direct acting drugs. So in this video, majorly important drugs I'm going to talk about is direct acting drugs. Okay. Now, let's start with adrenaline. Okay. So adrenaline will stimulate alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2. So what will happen? Vasoconstriction, okay. Heart rate will increase, okay. Now, how exactly this alpha 1 action and beta 2 action is working? So what we need to understand here is adrenaline at high concentration stimulate alpha 1 receptor. Adrenaline at low concentration stimulate beta 2 receptor. Now, every time we have adrenaline rush, so that is alpha 1 stimulation and vasoconstriction, BP is elevated. Okay. Now, we know all these things. So, adrenaline is produced from our adrenal medulla. We know all of it. But where do we use adrenaline in treatment? Where do we use it in the treatment? Okay. Let's see a patient who is under cardiac arrest. So, we can use adrenaline in the cardiac arrest treatment. Okay. Where else we can use adrenaline? In the anaphylactic shock. So, what is happening during anaphylactic shock? Due to that allergic reaction, whatever is triggered, bronchus is constricting. During anaphylactic shock, bronchus is constricting. And if I put adrenaline, so it will be helpful for the patient. Along with that, the patient is going into shock. So when patient is going into shock, what will happen? The blood pressure is going down. That will help the patient to get elevated blood pressure. Okay. Where else we can use? We can use it in bronchial asthma. In severe asthma. So during asthma, we don't need systemic effect. So we use it by inhalation. Okay. Now, since it is a natural substance, it is metabolized by an enzyme called COMT. So this COMT is an enzyme which metabolizes both adrenaline and noradrenaline, and it is excreted. The metabolites of the adrenaline and noradrenaline are excreted in urine. So this is how our adrenaline works. So let's talk about noradrenaline. And don't confuse, adrenaline is nothing but epinephrine. Noradrenaline is nothing but norepinephrine. So, we are talking about noradrenaline. So, when we are talking about noradrenaline, it will stimulate only alpha 1, alpha 2 and beta 1 receptor. Okay. So, when it is stimulating only alpha 1, alpha 2 and beta 1 receptor, it has only used during shock. It is main uses in the shock. So what happens? Let's see. When I put noradrenaline in a patient, what will happen? So it will cause, it will stimulate alpha 1. That will cause vasoconstriction and that will increase the blood pressure. Okay. This increased blood pressure will help the patient who is under shock. So we treated the shock. Okay, this is the useful effect. Now, this increased blood pressure, what it will do? This increased blood pressure will stimulate the baroreceptor. Okay, when baroreceptor stimulated, what will happen? Of course, we know it already. That will stimulate vagus nerve. Okay, now what will happen? That will cause decreased heart rate. So, as we can see, because of alpha 1 stimulation, we have a reflex bradycardia. But noradrenaline can also counteract this reflex bradycardia. What will happen? Noradrenaline will stimulate beta 1 receptor. Now, it will increase the heart rate. So, it can be contradicted with the beta 1 stimulation. So, this is a story of our noradrenaline. Okay. Now let's see about other drugs. We can have a group of drugs which stimulate only alpha receptors, right? we can have a group of drugs which can stimulate only beta receptor. Now let's talk about alpha adrenomimetics. But before going to alpha adrenomimetics, I want to discuss about one important drug, that is dopamine. So dopamine, we already know it is an intermediate metabolite which is produced during adrenaline and noradrenaline formation. This dopamine can stimulate dopamine receptor, that is D1 and D2. Okay. Meanwhile, dopamine at high concentration will stimulate alpha 1. At low concentration, it will stimulate beta 1 receptors. So it is similar to that of, little bit similar to that of our adrenaline. Okay, but here it is beta 1, there it is beta 2. Okay. Now see what is the use. When I stimulate alpha 1 receptor, what will happen? Increases the vascular resistance. When vascular resistance is increased, definitely BP is increasing. Increase the blood pressure. Okay. When blood pressure is increasing, definitely we know we can use this during treatment of shock. Okay. What type of shocks we can use it? We can use it during septic shock, maybe cardiogenic shock. Okay. Now, but what is a good effect with dopamine? We need to remember is this D1 and D2 receptor. This D1 and D2 receptor, they are located in two locations. Renal vasculature and mesenteric vessels. In both locations, mesenteric vessels and renal vasculature, they cause vasodilation. See, now let's take a patient who is having renal failure, who is having kidney failure, and he has a shock, for example. So what will happen? Blood supply to the kidneys maintained with the help of D1 and D2. Anyways, because of alpha 1 stimulation, it will cause increased vascular resistance and it increases the blood pressure. So we are protecting kidney and we are helping the visceral organs. Meanwhile, we are treating the shock. So this is the one important good use about dopamine. So dopamine is also a natural substance, so it is metabolized easily and excreted from the body. Okay, now we know about dopamine. Now let's talk about alpha adrenomimetics. So alpha adrenomimetics, we have alpha 1 receptor, we have alpha 2 receptor. Okay. We can have a group of drugs which stimulate both alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptor. So when we are talking about stimulation of alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptor, we have some drugs called as oxymetazoline and xylometazoline. Okay, these both zolines are used in the treatment of nasal decongestion. They are used for the treatment of nasal decongestion. Okay, so they are used as a nasal decongestant. Okay, now we can have a group of drugs which stimulate only alpha 1 receptor. So that include a drug called phenylephrine. The same use for phenylephrine again in the treatment as a nasal decongestant. So this is a story of alpha 1 stimulant. Okay. So this is a story of alpha 1 and 2 stimulant. All we are left with alpha 2 stimulation. Remember that starting part of our lecture, I told about alpha 2 stimulation. Alpha 2 stimulation is used for the treatment of hypertension. So we have a drug called clonidine. So it is mainly used in the treatment of hypertension. So this is a story of our alpha 2 stimulants. Okay. Now we are done with alpha mimetics, we are left with beta adrenomimetics. Okay. Generally, beta receptors are classified into beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. But to our pharmacological purposes, we don't study about beta 3. We majorly discuss about beta 1 and beta 2. Okay. Now, let's talk about beta 1 and beta 2. Okay. We can have a group of drugs, same story, which stimulate both beta 1 and beta 2 receptor. So, that drug is isoproterenol. Okay. So, actually isoproterenol is not much mostly used in the treatment because it is pretty difficult, or maybe we can call it as like, you know, combined condition. We see it not that frequently, but we can use isoproterenol. But we'll see about beta 1 stimulation. So, beta 1 agonist, where we can use? We can use it during the treatment of acute heart failure. So, the drug includes dobutamine. So, what is the name of this drug that is dobutamine? It is also called as inotropic drug. So, it is used for the treatment of acute heart failure. Now, we are left with beta 2 agonist. Okay, let's talk about beta 2 agonist. Beta 2 agonists are classified into two groups. Short acting beta 2 agonist, long acting beta 2 agonist. That is SABA and LABA. Okay, we have one important drug in short acting beta 2 agonist, that is salbutamol. And the another long acting beta 2, that is salmeterol. We have femetrol. Okay, so it's very easy. Wherever you see a metro in the drug, that is long acting beta 2 agonist. We have one more drug, that is ritodrine in beta 2 agonist. Okay, where do we use this beta 2 agonist? So, where do we want to stimulate beta 2 receptor? Where there is a bronchoconstriction. If you want to treat that patient who is having bronchoconstriction and difficulty to breathe, we need to use beta 2 agonist. So, that is bronchial asthma. So, beta 2 agonists are used in the treatment of bronchial asthma. Okay, and remember the other location where I told the beta 2 receptors are present, that is uterus. So, stimulation of beta 2 receptors in the uterus, it will cause uterus to relax. So, we use it in the treatment of premature labor. So, these are the important pharmacological effects of the adrenomimetics. Thank you guys. Keep following.